No, yeah. Balconies. You didn't know anywhere only under the balcony, and you done all your business from the balcony.
Four generations probably have been raised out of the one family, the one house, the one flat. That's all gone now.
It was good and bad, yeah. It was good and bad. There were some great people. Some of the nicest people I've ever met lived around here. And there was others.
There used to be more than 200 families living in O'Devany Gardens.
But now there's fewer than 15.
We're here for a look around this complex, which is due to be knocked down very soon.
So click and drag with your mouse, or move your phone or tablet to take a look around with us. Dublin had a housing problem in the post-war era. Neglected, overcrowded tenement buildings of the inner city were deemed unsuitable. Part of the response was to move families to huge new flat complexes like this one. Other blocks like Dolphin House, St. Teresa's Gardens and Fatima Mansions were dotted throughout the city. Many of the families in those flat complexes stayed for generations. Here in O'Devany Gardens, it was no different.
My mother came from Bambobsey up here. She came from a one room. She thought she was sharing the flat with three people, you know, all the different rooms. They were brilliant. She even thought they were brilliant. The only reason she moved is because she was up the top and she was old.
So, Teresa, can you remember the day that you moved to the flats?
Yes. Put my furniture in the pram and we pushed the stuff up to the flats.
And what year was that?
It was the same year I was with her. That's 1954. I hope so, anyway.
Yeah, you were with me.
I was with you, yeah.
Pushing the furniture up in the pram, all the baby's prams.
Did it feel like a big change?
I found Corrine Street was a big difference.
Oh, yeah.
We had only one room with Corrine Street, and there were six of us in the one room.
Yeah.
And a tile out the back garden.
I was born and raised here. 40-odd years, 48 years now.
How did you find it?
It was a great place. Still is a good place, but the community is gone. All the neighbours, all the old neighbours and all is gone. Like, we always had things going. We always got together and got things going, but that's all gone now.
When fully occupied, more than 270 families lived in O'Devany.
Everybody knew everyone.
Real families.
Everyone, you know.
Flats and
everybody knew everybody.
Tenement attitude carried on into the flats for the first, say, 20 years. Because you could get everything in the flats. You get your dripping, you get your waste, you know, your peelings and your things like that. There was a lady down below who could take the waste stuff, the skins. She'd give you a couple of covers for the skins. She had a barrel outside her flat. So you just dumped your booker in there, knocked at the door. I put a barrel booker in, there's a couple of coppers. So she had pigs.
Joe built his own little box car and collected bottles and went down to the rag stores with them and sold them.
When heroin swamped Dublin in the early part of the 1980s, O'Devany wasn't spared. A massive economic downturn saw unemployment rates soar. Residents battled drugs and job losses while trying to maintain a community. O'Devany was soon perceived as one of numerous problematic flat complexes in the city. Since then, locals have been trying to fight that perception.
Reputation would date back to probably over 20 years ago. I mean, there hasn't been any sort of aggravation in these flats for a long, long time.
Bernard Parker runs the shop in the centre of the flats.
My father bought a shop here in May 1977. We moved here in May 1977. I've been here since I could walk, basically. I was six when we bought here. I remember the day we moved into O'Devany. And since I was very, very young, I was over here working on my spare time. And I'm full-time here since 1988. I'm not going to paint it up as being perfect. It's not perfect. Nothing is perfect. And you get grief now and again, you get everything. But it was nowhere bad as the reputation got it.
The 80s was a big change with all the robbed cars and things like that. But just some families, a couple of families you had that there was no control over the kids, really, as such. But They used to bring their cars into the field and they may run them up and down some of the nights there and burn them out then afterwards. But that's why you see some of the railings around the free end, the pitch. Some of the railings are actually smashed because you get one car and you smash into it, go off and get another car and then drive over it and into the field with the other one. So they were fairly handy getting cars.
Things improved after the community and city began to get to grips with problems locally.
And then, like, in the summer, we'd all sit out and get swimming pools, fill them up for the kids. They were all great times, they were great memories.
But residents who have lived here for decades say in the last few years, things have changed again for the worse.
Never be afraid to walk through them.
Never. Never. You could leave anything out. Your key in your door all night.
Yeah. Or your key in the letterbox with the last person coming in.
Yeah. all changed.
It's all gone.
It's all gone.
You're even afraid to come up the stairs. Even if the gate is locked, you're afraid to climb up the poles.
Yeah.
Over the decades, many families have taken offers of housing nearby, owned by the council. Some saw it as making an escape. Others saw it as the only option to get away from flats that they felt were too small or had issues with damp.
The kitchen was the only problem. Yeah. It was small, you couldn't get a table.
It's the bedrooms, are you?
Yeah.
The bedrooms. Mm-hmm. The house is not as big. Yeah. Don't think in the house you have a big kitchen and a back garden.
That's all.
The sitting rooms are huge in them.
Michelle is one of the last remaining residents. She's due to move out in the coming days.
To think it's a whole new life for you. Well, I'm having here all my life. And to change, it is a big change. Now, don't get me wrong, the house that I got is lovely. Couldn't ask for a better house, but it's just the thought of having to move now. What way am I going to be? Am I going to be nervous up there? And look, I'm saying I wish I was back in the flats. As it is now, it's a thing that gets into you.
Like many others, when the option came, Joe and Teresa moved across the road to a house in Montpellier Gardens.
You would miss the people in the flats because the house was more, you know, you didn't see so many.
You didn't see nobody.
You had the balconies and most of the women spent their day on the balcony if they weren't working in the new house, you know. It was company.
Yeah, and that was how you talked to each other.
He didn't go out an awful lot.
It was communal, it was more so than company. There was always somebody walking up the stairs, you know, or either looking out over the balcony. And if there wasn't somebody in your place, there was somebody walking through the flats that you knew on the other side. So there's always still plenty of tentacles reaching out to everyone going around you.
The blocks have been gradually boarded up and demolished over the last decade or so. Those who remain say that this exacerbated the problems.
They had the cats in
there. No. Foxes. Foxes are coming up down the stairs.
It was originally the plan to redevelop the housing as part of a partnership with property developer Bernard McNamara, but he went bankrupt in the bust. The plan fell apart. There are 4 blocks left standing of 13. These fields were the sites of the demolished blocks. Fewer than 10 flats of 276 remain occupied.
It's very sad to see them. Very depressing looking at them. Mm. It was years ago to be on the bikes and all the kids with the Christmas morning, they'd be all going under. Christmas morning, well, I don't be here anymore.
Yeah, but it was brilliant. Do you remember the year at the ESB went? Remember that? And only a handful had gas cookers. Only anyone that had a gas cooker was able to cook the turkey, and they were cooking it for everybody.
Sounds like
Max. It was at the time.
Enough cooker one Christmas dinner.
I'm telling you, yeah. But at least you could depend on them, you know.
When we lived them 2 blocks boarded up, so we can look at them. You can look at them, and see that's boarded up. We know that the Brasses lived here, the Parkinsons, the Huttons, the Reddies, the Bradys. I mean, so we look at them, we can see families. You can just see boarded up.
It is, and it is. There's going to be tears when I'm gone. It is going to be sad now leaving them. I wish I could just bring the flat with me. And the neighbours, jeez, the neighbours are brilliant. Like, I'm like the last one. I just had to have a big family. And I'm the last one of the whole lot of them that slept in the flats. I was the first to move into them out of the mall, and I'm the last. Oh, Christy. And I'm the last one.
She was born in these flats. She was born here, was she? Yeah.
You used to push her in the prams.
It wasn't that pram, was it?
It's Elba Cross. Now, he actually lived up in Air Block, and he was the type of man that put, with his bare hands, put two bikes together, and one would cycle in the front and stare, and the other used to cycle at the back. What do you call them bikes?
Tandems.
Yeah.
Some of the other last residents say they're still waiting on an offer of housing somewhere they want.
I'm not budging until I get where I want now. You know what I mean? There's only the handful of us left. They haven't looked after us at all, so we're not moving until we get where we want.
I want an iron, and I'm sticking out. Stop them builders coming in here. Yeah.
The last of the blocks are expected to be knocked down at some point in the next 12 months.
Do you worry about what's going to happen to the shop and to you and your wife when the last resident eventually walks out of here?
No, I don't. I used to worry about a lot of things, but I don't worry about that anymore. Life's too short. We just have to batten down and hold on. Something has to happen here. I don't know exactly what's going to happen, but something has to.